The young man that I have on the prayer list, Noah, a four-year-old little boy, he's a great-grandson of my aide. God is so good. I just have to say he's so good. He has turned this young man around completely. They were talking about doing a blood transfusion, another drainage tube. They did put the other drainage tube in, but he did it. God has completely healed him, did a 180. They've removed the blood, drainage tubes, and they have taken the blood transfusion off the table. Amen. And he might come home today or tomorrow. Amen. So praise glory praise to God for the praises praise that he gives us.
Yep. Thanks for sharing that. And Matt, we lifted up him in prayer, and he's making recoveries from playing around with the chainsaw.
And Matt, share, if you don't mind, share what you share with me. If
that's okay. Well, I do sheet metal for a living, and I've dealt with cutting myself a lot. And Monday, I could have possibly cut my hand off. And in 1 week, this cut's healed.
Amen.
The stitches are almost falling out.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I've never had a cut healed this fast in my entire life.
Praise the Lord.
Praise God.
Thank you for your prayer.
Praise God.
Good things happening because of the Lord.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, our scripture reading this morning comes from James chapter 4, verse 7. Submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. We're going to go ahead and stand and have our opening prayer and worship God through praise and song.
Almighty God, you are a holy, holy, holy. We lift up your name. Thank you for praises and the testimony of how you have healing power, Father. All those prayers that were lifted up to you, Father, you answered. We know that you do answer prayer. direct us. And Father, be with Chris as he brings the message today. May it cut to our hearts. We can take it to our life each day of the week, not just today, but every day that we go out into the world. May we be your hands, your feet, your mouthpiece. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Save the wretch, I read.
says, "For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross." And then over in 2 Corinthians 5:18-19, it says, "All this from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against him. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Now, because of Adam's sin, harmony between God and man was destroyed, but the disorder also came to creation. And that's why in Sunday school, the second scene we've learned is corruption. Corruption came into the world because of Adam's sin. And the death of Christ was the only thing to reconcile God and bring harmony to us as well as the physical world. And although the full realization of that isn't going to happen until Christ returns, that's why in 1 Corinthians we're told to partake of the bread and cup weekly until he returns. But I want you to consider what I just read in verse 22 of Colossians. It says, "But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you," listen to this, "holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation." That's how wonderful and marvelous God's grace is. You're presented holy before God the Father because of what Christ did for you at Calvary and the blood that was shed for you and I. Let's praise God, and as we come to the table, partake of the bread and cup, thinking of what Christ did for us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we are so thankful to you, indebted to you, for what you have done for us at Calvary. We're only able to be reconciled to you through the blood of Christ, the perfect, unblemished Lamb of God. Just now, as we come to the table, help us to recognize that as we partake of the bread representing your body and the juice representing your blood. Forgive us, Lord, when we do sin. Help us to repent. Love one another. Come together as a unified body in Christ as we gather around this table. For it's in Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's a wonderful thing to be still before the Lord and to take time and pause and reflect and be thankful and praise Him. The Lord's at work. The Lord's at work. The Lord's been doing stuff that only He can do. And that's extremely encouraging. People are giving their lives to Jesus. I know of another this week, praise the Lord. Good things are happening. Young people are growing in the faith. Older people are growing in the faith. People are serving. Good things are happening. That being said, when you start getting on a roll and things start to go really well, you need to continue to pray for one another because the battle is intensifying as well. The last 4 weeks have been spiritual warfare in different forms. And we just need to continue to pray for one another and lift each other up, and God will bring us through. And good things in the Lord are happening. Now, I want to share something with you before I get to the sermon. And I'm just going to share from the heart here. Parents, grandparents, I need your help. The Lord tells us in Matthew 28 to go and make disciples, to teach, to baptize, and to teach. I know there are lots of things that your children and grandchildren could be doing this summer. But I believe with all my heart that if we put God first, and we put the things of God first, that our children will grow in the faith, they will grow in the Word of God, they will grow in development. If they go with open hearts, that is key. They need to have an open heart when they go. But if they go with an open heart, and they are focused on the Lord, and they spend time in the Scriptures, they will develop stronger character, develop their gifts, and with God's help in time, go on and serve God and make disciples wherever God calls them to be. I know there's a lot of things that your kids and grandkids could be involved in this summer. But I've seen churches that really do well are ones that prioritize the things of the kingdom first. So I want to encourage you guys. We've got two main events that we have every summer. One is Vacation Bible School. So for all the little ones that want to help out with that, that's great. The little ones that want to be part of that, that's great. And all the adults that want to help serve with that, that's great. So please be a part of that. But also is Cedar Creek Christian Camp. So, it's an excellent camp. They do a great job. And Robin went last year. Sarah's going to go this year. I went last year. Denise went last year. But if you want to go as a parent, just observe and see the things that are happening, go work a week, that's great. Just let us know so we let the dean know. They do background checks on everybody. But it's a great Christian camp in order for your young people to grow in the Lord. Last year we had 11 from the church go, but we had 3 additional kids from Vacation Bible School go, so we ended up having 14, go off from memory on that, but I think we ended up having 14 go from the church and from Vacation Bible School go last year, and hopefully we'll have more than that go this year. So, I realize there's a lot of different stuff they could do, but please take a look at this, and we'll willing, if you're able to, sign them up for a week at camp. It'd be really a great thing for them in their walk with God. Some of my best memories growing up were at church camp. So let's start with the word. Oh yes, John.
Mike.
Yeah, it's on. Well, sorry. Apologize. I thought it was on. All right. Anyway, apologize. Okay. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you're holy, that you're faithful, and that you're true and you're good. To you, God, be all the glory for all the good and wonderful things that you are doing. Thank you for how you're working, God, through your Holy Spirit and by your word and how you're answering your prayer. God, you are good. You are good. Help us, God, to draw closer to you, and God, to be your people, and God, to live for you each day, to help make disciples, God. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today we'll be continuing in Luke in chapter 4. I thought about breaking this up a little bit, but I was like, no, I'm going to go ahead and finish up Luke chapter 4. We're going to move to Luke chapter 5 next week. So, We're talking about how Jesus went back to his own hometown. He went back to his own hometown. So, over the years, the Lord has allowed me to study the scriptures in different ways. Bible character studies, parables, miracles. Yeah, the battery's dead. That just happened.
Because it flashed the green thing at me.
Okay, sorry about that, y'all. It flashed green initially and it went off. Or I can just use this one.
You move around a lot.
Yeah. Thank you, bud. Appreciate that.
All right, we'll try this again. Okay.
Okay, so Jesus going back to his own hometown in Luke in chapter 4. Over the years, the Lord has allowed me to study the scriptures in different ways. Bible character studies, parables, miracles, different things like that. To me, this series is very interesting because it's not completely chronological. However, it is much more chronological in the study of the life of Jesus. And I've studied the life of Jesus in many different aspects, and miracles and parables and all those different things. But this is the first time that I can remember going through chapter by chapter, going through the life of Jesus. So, and ministry of Jesus. So I find that very interesting. So Jesus returns to Nazareth. Jesus returns to Nazareth. This week we're starting with Jesus returning to his own hometown, not where he was born, because he was born where?
Bethlehem.
But where he spent his childhood and where he grew up. Mark Moore writes this: Jesus has been away from Nazareth for almost a year now. He's been baptized by John. He spent 40 days and 40 nights in the desert being tempted by Satan. He's attracted his first few followers. He's performed a miracle at Cana. He's performed a number of miracles, in fact, and spent 8 or 9 months gaining disciples. Yeah, there it is. Much better. Okay, thank you. Okay, so he now returns to his home county. He now returns to his home county, but this is not his home. And yes, that's a play on words there. Okay, he's doing a preaching tour. He's going through several cities. He's going to synagogues, including Cana, where he heals the nobleman's son. He's preaching at this time, and preaching at this time was very popular. It was a very popular thing, preaching. And popular preaching was often followed. So, such is the case with Jesus. His intrigue is spreading throughout the region as he goes through preaching the good news of the kingdom of heaven. So, he now returns to the town where he was brought up, where he was, and the term there means nurtured, okay? Not only did Jesus grow up here, he was nourished here, he was nurtured here, he matured here. Here in Nazareth is where he went to school, where he learned to trade, where he potentially even maybe played some sports. This was the hometown boy making it big, okay? So this is the hometown boy making it big. They were glad to see him initially, okay? We're going to pick up in Luke chapter 4 and verse 14. Jesus returns to Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit, and the news about him spread throughout the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everybody praised him. Verse 16. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day, he went to the synagogue, which was his custom. Now, Jesus attended worship services regularly. Jesus is our Lord. Jesus is our example. And I'm very encouraged at how God is blessing us and that we're gaining momentum in this area. Okay? I'm very encouraged by that. But Jesus made a point to attend worship service every week. So should we. Hebrews 10:25 tells us, "Do not forsake the fellowship of the believers, as some are in the habit of doing, but encourage each other all the more as you see the day approaching." And what's the day? What day is that? That's the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. When Jesus returns to his home turf, we're not surprised to find him in the synagogue. That was the place of worship at that time. All eyes were on him. We can just imagine the elders reminiscing about what a fine student Jesus was growing up in Sabbath school. Naturally, Jesus was the guest preacher for the day. From a Jewish standpoint, this was a completely normal practice. The preacher would stand up and read the scripture, and then he would sit down and he would teach the people. And that's exactly what Jesus does. Jesus chose the sermon text for that day. As the visiting preacher, he would have had the right to choose the text for that day. So he chose the text. The sermon was expected to be biblically accurate, and precise and somewhat interesting from a literary point of view. The sermon was typically given by a trained rabbi, but a prominent visitor such as Jesus might also have come in to speak. Jesus also, though, was a rabbi, although his hometown yet didn't know it, okay? So Jesus chose the text, and the text is from Isaiah chapter 61 and verses 1 and 2. And it clearly describes the ministry of the Messiah. Picking up in Luke chapter 4, verse 17, it says this. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of the sight of the blind, and to release the oppressed. Verse 19, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Jesus, very calmly, through the scriptures, has just announced that he is the anointed one. Okay, so he did it the first time through the scriptures. He just announced through the scriptures that he is the anointed one to his hometown. He is the Messiah. He's announced that to his hometown crowd. Now, the Messiah's ministry is described in several ways. He would be filled with and he would be led by the Holy Spirit. He would release the oppressed. This literally means that those that have been broken to pieces, he would release the oppressed. Jesus released shattered lives from the oppressors that they have experienced. He comforts those who mourn. He is gentle and he is kind. The Messiah would also be a miracle worker. He would heal the blind and many others. He also proclaimed the year of the Lord's favor. That literally means the acceptable year of the Lord. This infers the year of Jubilee. Now, does anybody understand what the year of Jubilee is? Anybody know about that? What's the year of Jubilee?
All debts are forgiven.
Yes, well done. Okay? So, it's the year of Jubilee. And there's some things going on. Helen was losing the tooth earlier. Anyway, so I don't know if that's still related. But anyway, this I gotta tell you, I'm telling y'all, it's something different every week. It's completely random. But be praying. Prayer makes a difference, okay? All right, so the acceptable year of the Lord. This infers the year of Jubilee, when the things were released or returned to their original owners. The year of Jubilee happened every 50th year, okay? It is a picture of what Jesus did for us at Calvary and through the resurrection. All eyes were fastened on him. The word that is used there implies extreme emotion. So they're all locked in, looking at Jesus. He's just read the scripture about the Messiah. Okay? All right? And it says they're focused on him. And the word that's used there, there's a ton of emotion behind the people's hearts. Okay? This room is full. It's very tense. Okay? At the moment. Now, some of the emotions were good, some of them were bad. Okay? So, people love good preaching, and Jesus, in a few short words, in a few short months that they've been away, he had quite a reputation as a preacher and developed quite a reputation as a preacher. Rumors are beginning to spread now that he possibly could be the Messiah. So, what is Jesus going to say? In the crowd there was a wide range of feelings. There was some of anticipation. There was some of pride. There was some of friendship. There was some of jealousy. There were some who even thought that they were superior to Jesus. Watch how Jesus meets all their expectations head on. Okay? He meets all their expectations head on. We're going to pick up in verse 20. Then he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. And then Jesus said this. Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Jesus has just confirmed to his hometown audience that he indeed is the Son of God, that he indeed is the Messiah in his own words. He used the scripture first, and now he's done so in his own words. In your minds, you can imagine the collective breathing of, what did he just say? Right? They shouldn't have been in shock. They should have understood I should have understood. But in Luke chapter 4, verse 22, all spoke well of him. They were amazed. They were amazed at his gracious words that came from his lips. And they said, "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. So Jesus rebuked them for their lack of faith. Jesus goes on to say this in Luke chapter 4, verse 23. "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Do here in your hometown what you have done, what you did in Capernaum.' I tell you the truth," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his own hometown." And every time I've seen that, I believe that to be true. No prophet is accepted in his own hometown. Was this true? Absolutely. What was there a problem? Yes, there's a problem. What was the problem? It was a lack of faith. It was a lack of respect. It was a lack of reverence for God. It was a lack of believing in him as being the Son of God, the Messiah. How many times was Jesus rejected by his own people? In John chapter 1, verse 11, it says this, "He came to that which was his own." Who were they?
Jews.
Who were his own?
Jews.
He came to that which was his own. He came to Israel, the Jewish people, but they did not receive him. John 1, 11 says it. Jesus shows how God blessed those who had faith. And interestingly enough, it was not the Jews. Notice what Jesus says next. We'll get here in just a minute. But then Jesus continues his rebuke to them by showing how much Israel lacked faith during the days of Elijah and Elisha, and how no miracles were done there due to their lack of faith. But instead, God did miracles in places where people did have faith. Those outside of Israel. Verse 25, "I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to the widow of Zarephath in the region of Sidon, and there were many in Israel with leprosy at the time of Elisha the prophet. Yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian." Now there are tons of scriptures where God chose to act because the people had faith. That's extremely important. Because the people had faith, they saw God work. Okay? Just a quick search, it came up with over 100 verses where God or Jesus said, "According to your faith, it will be done to you." The great importance of us having faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to give you some examples here. Okay, one is from Matthew chapter 9, verses 27 through 29. "And as Jesus passed on from there, two blind men followed him, crying aloud, 'Have mercy on us, Son of David. Have mercy on us, Son of David.'" They're blind. They're crying out to Jesus. "When he entered the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said to them, 'Do you believe that I am able to do this?'" Ask the question, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" They said to him, "Yes, Lord." Then he touched their eyes, saying, "According to your faith, be it done to you." And their eyes were opened. Another example, the Canaanite woman, whose daughter was demon-possessed in Matthew chapter 15, verse 25. The woman came and knelt before him, kneeling before Jesus, and said, "Lord, help me. Help me, Lord." She said, "Lord, help me." He explained, "It is not right to take the children." He explained, "It's not right to take the children's bread to toss it to their dogs." And she says, "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." And then Jesus answered this way, "Woman, you have great faith. You have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. We must remember this is extremely important teaching and a command of God as well. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says this, "Without faith, it is impossible to please God." Without faith, it's impossible to please God because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. We must have faith. His hometown was amazed at his teaching. They were amazed at his preaching. But they did not have faith that he was the Son of God. As a result, their amazement turned to fury chose not to work in Israel in Elijah and Elisha's day, Jesus himself would not do major miracles in his own hometown because of their lack of faith. Mark 6, 5 and 6 says this. He could not do any miracles there except to lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. He was amazed at their lack of faith. Now there's only two times in Scripture where it ever says that Jesus was amazed. Only two times. Can you guys remember? I just gave you one of them. Remember the other? The one it says that Jesus is amazed is the Roman centurion. Okay? And with him it was because he had such great faith. But the other time is here in his own hometown. He is amazed at their lack of faith. This lack of faith also reminds us of the jeering that Jesus would take when he would be on the cross in Luke chapter 23, verse 35. It says, they said to him, he saved others. Let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, the chosen one. The soldiers and one of the criminals next to him made similar remarks. Due to their lack of faith, due to their lack of reverence for God, they tried to kill Jesus. This is his hometown. His hometown people are trying to kill him because they do not believe in him. Okay? All the people in the synagogues were furious when they heard this. They got up and they drove him out of the town. And they took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to do what? To throw him from the cliff. But verse 30 says this. He walked right through the crowd. And he went on his way. Now to these ritualistic Jews. Now I'm going to back up on it. I got to be careful with this one, but I believe if you're walking with the Lord and you're doing what God wants you to do, I've seen God protect people that do that. Many, 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 many times over. From certain death. Car accidents, storms, sickness. When God has a plan for your life and you're seeking to walk with him, from my perspective at least, I've seen God intervene to protect those people over and over and over and over again. It's not easy. I've seen God protect those people over and over and over again. They're trying to kill Jesus. Yet his time has not yet come. And so he walks right through them, and he goes on fulfilling what God has called him to do, fulfilling the ministry that God has called him to fulfill. To these ritualistic Jews, this would have been way over the line. They thought to themselves, we're God's people. God will only do miracles for us. That's what they were thinking to themselves. God would never do miracles for outsiders. Why would God do such a thing? At this, their amazement changed to rage and to fury. The word in the Greek here means that they use for amazement, it falls short of genuine faith. They're amazed. They're amazed at his teaching. They're amazed at his preaching, but they do not believe that he is the Son of God. They do not have faith in him. The bottom line is that these people were good at talking about Jesus, but they were not committed to Jesus. They're good at talking about Jesus, but they were not committed to Jesus. They are impressed by the preaching ability, but they're infuriated by the message that he brings. His hometown wanted to kill him, and they would have done so if they could have. But it was not God's will. God's plan was Jesus would go on to be and to do what God wanted him to do, and he escaped the mob. He escaped the mob and went on to do his ministry. This people's lack of faith and people's rebellious behavior sets up a pattern that will continue throughout the early church, and frankly, I think even up to today. Those that have humble hearts and have faith and trust the Lord God will often see God work in ways that people who do not have faith will never see. I'm going to read that again. Those that have humble faith in God will often see God work in ways that those who do not have faith won't. Now, in the rest of the chapter, we're going to move on down here. In the rest of the chapter, Jesus dials it up. In verse 31 through 37, Jesus goes to Capernaum, a town in Galilee, on the Sabbath. They're amazed at his teaching because his message, it says, what it had authority. Verse 33, in the synagogue, that is the place of worship, there was a man possessed by a demon, an evil spirit. The evil spirit cried out at the top of his voice, "Ah! What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," Jesus said sternly. "Come out of him." Then the demon threw the man down before them all and came out of him without injuring him. All the people were amazed and said, "What is this teaching? With authority and power to give order to evil spirits and they come out." And the news about him spread throughout the surrounding area. We can see from this several things. Demons clearly know who the Lord Jesus Christ is. They clearly know who the Lord Jesus Christ is. They know that he is the Holy One of God. They also know that he is coming back to punish them. We see that Jesus is far more powerful and that he rebukes evil spirits easily. We see that Jesus cares about individuals. This man was set free, and yet he himself was not injured. God is blessing Jesus' ministry, and his ministry is gaining momentum. Now, skipping around to verse 38. Jesus goes to Simon's house and heals his mother-in-law. So, Jesus goes to the house of Simon. Now, this is before his name is changed to Peter. Okay? He goes to the house of Simon. Simon's mother-in-law is very sick and with a very high fever. They asked Jesus to help. So he, Jesus, bent down and rebuked the fever, and it left her. She got up at once and began to wait on him. We see here that Jesus not only has power over evil spirits and can rebuke them, but he also has authority over sickness as well, to rebuke sickness. And if it is his will, he can heal instantly, if it's his will. People begin to bring to Jesus those of various sicknesses, and he laid his hands on them and he healed them. Moreover, it says demons came out and many people were shouting. Many demons came out of the people shouting, "You are the Son of God." But he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak because they knew that he was the Christ. And how does the end of this chapter close out? It had been a very long time, very long day, a couple days. Notice what Jesus does early the next day. In verse 42 it says, At daybreak, Jesus went to a solitary place. What did Jesus often do in those solitary places?
Pray.
Spent time with God the Father to recharge his batteries and to get, focused and have, he did that every day. He sets that example for us. Yeah, I shared with the men's group last week, what were Jesus's, and we'll talk more about this next week, about the discipleship. But what were Jesus's priorities when he was here? What were the things that he committed himself to? Prayer, preaching, teaching, and discipleship. And yes, he also healed, okay? But prayer, preaching, teaching, and discipleship. At daybreak, Jesus went to a solitary place, very likely to spend time with God the Father and recharge his batteries and commune with God the Father. The people were looking for him, and they tried to keep him from leaving. Now, verse 43, Jesus keeps on preaching the good news from town to town. But he said, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns also, because this is why I was sent." And he kept on preaching in the synagogues of Judea. The chapter ends with him focused like a laser beam on what God the Father has asked him to do. He loves God. He spends time with God the Father. He is healing the people spiritually, and he is healing the people physically. He is preaching the good news of the kingdom of God. This morning, don't be like the people in Nazareth. What was their problem? They lacked faith. That they lacked faith. Don't be like the people in Nazareth that lacked faith, who rejected Jesus and saw virtually no miracles in their own hometown. Be like those who have faith. Trust in Jesus. Give God room in your heart to work. Repent of your sins and give your life to Jesus. Have faith in God and that God can do whatever he wants, whenever he wants, as long as it fits with his word and with his will. Have faith and let the Lord work powerfully in your life today. This morning, if you have a decision to make for Jesus Christ, please come forward as we sing our invitations. Good times, praise the Lord in the bad times, because God loves us and he's with us. I think of Job. You know, Job went through all that stuff. He lost his family, lost his home, lost all that, and yet he remained, well, he did question God, that one time. But overall, he remained faithful, and God blessed him and rewarded him in the long run. Let's make sure that we give God all the praise and all the glory and be his people and thank God for being at work in our lives. I'm going to ask Matt, will you have a closing prayer for us?
Father in heaven, truly praise the name of the Lord Jesus. You are so holy. We know that you give us so much hope with Jesus and with his life and his ministry, and all we can do is praise you. I know that sometimes things are taken away. Sometimes we don't understand them. But you gave us Jesus the Comforter. I pray this week that we don't understand. I pray this week that we continue to seek after you, continue to praise you, continue to just thank God for the things that we do have. We just love you, we praise you, we seek you, we worship you. Again, you are holy, holy, holy. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Live by, have faith, and live by the Holy Spirit. God loves you, we love you, have a great week. God bless. Thank you. I'm sorry. He kept going on and on.